Here he is. You've got to write us on, Jim. Click the little red button. That's it. Comes.
Rob, hello, Sam.
Hello, mate. How you doing?
Mate, I've had a... So sorry, mate.
Don't be silly. How are you?
I'm all right, son. I'm all right. Look at you. We finally got there, didn't we?
Yeah, mate.
I locked myself in the living room. I got the kid out there bashing drums with pots and pans. I said, don't interrupt me during this call. So we've got a nice little time together. I'm just going to get all cosy here, son. I'm going to get all cosy. Look, I've got my Buddha in the corner. Oh, he looks over me. Lovely jubbly. Do you know what I mean? This is my peace and quiet in my living room.
Lovely. So, Why is this about to do a song and drive like mad? She's saved them.
Look at the state of me. Shall I put a bit of product on or what? What are we saying? We're all right, aren't we?
Thanks for coming on, Jim, mate.
Shut up. You're all right.
It's brilliant to have you on, mate. Legend. But, we'll talk about the mime, really, Jim. Like, I've been having one with Sammy yesterday. Your power. It was funny, isn't it? It was good.
I've been speaking to him on that. On these as well as that Zoom. But Tamer's that I've been a big fan of Tamer. I love watching his films. I love the British like gangland gangster films, the budget fit, the low budget films if you want. But he's done some slick ones. Don't get me wrong. But I love watching that, him and Danny Dyer's the Football Factories when they first started, or even later business. Than that. The business was the nuts.
That was, wasn't it?
Massive Tamer fan, but this
even
is
even the soundtrack was bang on to that.
Oh, it's the nuts, isn't it? Whenever you're around the pool on holiday and all, you got to get the soundtrack on, isn't
it? Get the track.
And then when you go down Benoist, you're actually on the pool. You actually think you're in. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Put your white to sheen
and
your shorts.
And when people start chucking a few right-handers, I run.
It was him. What's that?
It's him. Oh, you don't get caught with me. I'm a proper grass. Don't worry about that. We're going to talk about the mind, yeah?
Yes, mate, yeah. So, first of all, Jim, I know that you're a real positive guy, you know? I've had a few chats and I know how positive you are, and that's a good thing. I thought that's a good thing to touch on the people to listen to us. Because everyone wants to talk about, the negativity, what's going on at the moment. There's enough of that on the news and everywhere else. So, I think it'd be good to get a touch on your mindset and how you sort of, how you've sort of processed it thought from day one, really, because it's just normal. You don't get depressed.
Yeah, I spoke to you the other day, and when I spoke to you, I said, I've never struggled with mental health. I get down days. Do you get what I mean? I get days when I wake up and I can't be bothered. But then I sort of ask myself, I don't want to stay in that process too long. I'm a really lively character, plenty of energy. So sometimes I think it's good to have a day in with the kids on the sofa just to recharge my battery. Yeah. So I don't see it as a down mental day. I see it as sort of a recharge day. That's how I've always seen it.
Yeah. And this life, isn't it?
Also, my mind's telling me, I don't want to do a lot sometimes, Rob. I blow out sometimes, you get what I mean? So I don't know where mental health comes in.
I think you've hit a good point, because a lot of people now, I think where everyone's focused on the mental health so much and anxiety and depression, when they have a day and a bit of a dip, they go, I'm depressed. It's anxious. I think sometimes I think people got used to this way of thinking that and putting our focus on it, that they pull themselves into a deeper state of depression just because they have
Is that possible? That was my question. Is that possible?
What?
Well, you pull yourself in.
Yeah,
Before you get there, you're pulling yourself in. You're sort of talking about, you think, oh, I'm up and depressed. And then you're sort of pulling it closer instead of...
Focusing on the good, and changing your emotional state. Everyone thinks that we've got to change our emotional state by the way we think, but we can put music on and change the state, I'm a big Happy Mondays fan, I'd be like you growing up, I was a proper Schumer, mate, down there, me, Biv and Brace, me Timberlands, proper indie bud, and back in the early 90s, and thought I was Sean Ryder, so whenever I feel down sometimes, I just whack that bit of Happy Mondays on, and let me think in life is a trigger, isn't it, there's that song that you can think, you put a song on, you might not hear it for 3 years, it come on the radio, it'll take you back to when you was other, when I be for when you was 18 with your pals, and you get an image, and then the image comes and you start to smile.
Music is very powerful, isn't it?
A bit, anchors, yeah, for anchoring and triggers massively.
I've noticed that.
I could put one of them old tunes on when I was a kid and I'd get that sort of buzz, like, yeah, I'm about to go out with mates, and it livens me up a little bit.
Yeah,
so
without a shadow.
Sometimes it ain't always about trying to, let's think about the problem that's going to make me feel worse. It's really about getting on that emotional change.
And
I think you're right that people do, they do, your question was, can it? When you practice focusing on something so long, it becomes like a trigger, just like that song becomes a trigger, makes you smile. You can get, I did it my way. How many times have I been in a pub in my life and some woman's sitting there crying when it's coming? I go, what's the matter? It was my granddad's funeral 5 years ago. I mean, definitely,
right,
it brings back all the sadness. Do you know what I mean?
Without a shadow of that.
So if people are trained and you're practicing with psychotherapy, keep talking about the problem, you start training your brain to focus on it and to access this emotional experience, because a long-term memory is a high emotional experience. People can definitely push themselves into that way.
It's weird, because we spoke lightly on the phone a few days ago, because I was real... I first see you on Jamie doing the pieces with Jamie O'Hara, not being first piece. And because I could relate to that, where Jamie, I'm quite close to Jamie and Welsh football, and similar levels as well. You know, sometimes it's too hard to connect to the elite, and sometimes it's too hard for me to connect to non-league without being rude. So Jamie's had a similar career to me, and I could really relate to him. And what you were saying about him having a goal, and he had his fixed firm. When he lost his goal and his sort of ambition, he had a goal, really. He had, like, I wanted to achieve that. That happened to me a little bit. I achieved everything I wanted, and sort of football come to an end, and I sort of fell in a bit, but, you know, I didn't have a goal. And then 2 years when I finished football, I lost my way a little bit. But then I had another goal, trying to carve a career. I went on the show, Celebrity, I'm a Celebrity, Get Me Out of It, a Jungle. Basically, that was to...
give you something to move forward to?
Give me... I didn't know my goal, but it was on the right path. You know, I see the paths, and I never knew where it was going to lead, if it was going to lead to anything. But what it gave me was an opportunity where it may lead to something.
Something.
Do you get what I mean? And I sort of went on there, and I was like, right, let's go on this show. It's a big show. I was a massive fan of it. And then I don't think I'd be doing Soccer Am if I didn't go on a show, Rob. So sometimes by grabbing opportunities that are available, because it was available, and with me opening my eyes and pushing my agent, get me. I want to go and have a meeting with him. I reckon I could get on there. I reckon I could switch on my buttons. I reckon I could. They'd be after me. You know, I'm a bit of this wacky character. I'll get it. I'll get it, and I'll be nuts on there. I'd love it on there. Do you get what I mean? Like, I'd absolutely love the show. And if me not going on there, I don't think I'd have been on Soccer Am and bits and other shows around it. I don't think I'd have opened up other people's eyes to go, right, he wants to be on TV.
What I can hear in you there is that you still got that sort of thing in you that you've got to go forward. Well, let's do it. I've got nothing else. I need something to... focus in the way you think. Like, if there's nothing there, you're looking, you're waiting for something to come along to...
Just to try to...
Which is you're thinking... What I keep saying to people is, people make things so complicated. I tell people, you think about what you want and look for things that you want, instead of keep thinking about what you don't want, your anxiety, you've got no money, you might lose your job. Instead of thinking about all that, start looking for things that you want. And if you put your focus towards what you want instead of what you don't want, things do start coming your way because you're creating them, you know?
It's mad, like what you just said there. I'll pick up on a little thing. And this is this chat we're having. It's going to branch. I'm a nightmare. I will never stay on the same road. And I'll pick things from you as much as you me. Because I'm all, what you just said, people make things too difficult. I've noticed that more and more.
You do. Complicated.
Like, I'm such a simple person. And the best things I've done in life, I've kept so simple. Black, white, yes, no. Attack it, don't attack it. Do you get what I mean?
Yeah,
like that basic caveman style.
The hardest thing for me to teach people is to think simple. That is they look at my therapist and they go, what is that it? I go, that's it. And they start applying it to their life. And they go, oh, yeah, mate, it's easy. I'm feeling because it should be easy. If things feel good, it should be easy. Do you know what I mean? When you walk in the street,
you're
makes
right.
you happy, comes easy most times. You notice the way you feel. Like, you want to go and buy a new pair of shoes. You walk and you look around. You look, you know, ain't like when you've got them, you feel buzzing. It ain't hard. You just got to make your mind up.
Yeah. Do these come across often as well, right? I see a lot of these. Where I was a builder, decorator, come handyman before football, we used to call them doers. More than talkers. The amount of like mates I have, and you hear them, you'll be in the pub having a pint, they'd be like, yeah, getting into property, got to do this and that. And you speak to 3 months down the line, I'm like, where are you with that? And he goes, nah, I ain't done it yet. Like, do you hear that? Like, I'm a big doer, I think. I think I'm a big doer. Like I said, I'm going to do all my pack. Brian, go on.
No, sorry, Jim. Sorry, go on. I was just thinking that sorry, mate.
Take over. You're the governor. Let's go.
What I was going to say, what you just said then, is the reason why I've been really thinking about this lately, because you asked me a few questions about it the other day. You mentioned saying it's been on my mind. That I think the difference is, at an unconscious level, when you think about something you're going to do, inside your head, you create the vision and you sort of, you get into it so deeply that you experience the emotion of what it's going to feel like and you get that bit of attachment to it. When people are just talking without a vision, some sort of way it's going to look in there, or some sort of map how it's going to look, they don't get an emotional connection. So you're not connecting your unconscious mind. So if you ain't got your conscious and your unconscious together, they're just words. Do you know what I mean? And if you've got to keep running that process of thought again and again and again and again, again for you to actually start making change. So, for instance, how many people have I met in my life go, I want to go, I'd love to go to Australia. I've always wanted to go there. They're like fucking 50 years old and they've been. But every time it's been like, but the last time they thought about going to Australia, it was 7 months ago when someone else sees something on telly. So they've never kept, they don't keep the thought alive. And if you keep the thought alive, what you want again on a daily basis, that's when it creates that will, not willpower, the will, like the motivation that pulls you towards it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, without a shadow. I get it. It's the same with, like we spoke about, football, and I'm going to bring my dad in this chat because I know we talk about our dads later, but they've had a similar experience. I want to bring that up a bit later. But my dad was so positive, Rob, to a point where his positivity was so strong. Oh, mine wasn't that strong, Rob. He'd see me as, if you used to ask my dad back in the day, it was the best player he'd seen, he'd go, Jim, you're up there. You're up there, like you are in the elite group. I see you do bits that other people can't do. And I didn't have that at 19, 20. I was like, Dad, are you all right? Like, you sure about this? Are you really mean here? And then all of a sudden, it took actions, Rob, for me to really have his belief in me. It took like a goal or a long range pass or a collection of games. I'll tell you what it took. I scored 3 goals, and this ain't me bigging me up, by the way, so forget this. It was an episode of game. It took 3 goals, and I was all in goal of the month. That was a close period. My career from that month, Rob, I'm not joking, went like that.
Shut up.
Mate, it was just like, from Peterborough, since that month, and I had a hard time at West Ham. I didn't crack it in the first team. I lost a load of confidence while I was in reserves, and I went to Peterborough, and that confidence, it was a new start for me, but I didn't quite grab that confidence and I dipped them into the first team. It was a big step for me going into first team football and it took me 3-4 months and I didn't get in the team. All of a sudden, I had this game, I hit a few passes and then I'm growing in this belief and all of a sudden, I hit a goal and then another goal and another goal. And after that, my career went like that because my dad's belief and everything he was telling me was coming to me and I was going, what I'm trying to get at is it took an action. It took a moment or a few moments to do it. With all the thought coming in here, believe. Do you know what I mean? Does it take actions as well? Of course,
100%. You've got to take, nothing happens without action. You've hit a nail on the head. And also when you said about, sometimes it's good that our parents sometimes put the image in our head. For your dad to say, I think you've got it, boy. You know, we listen. Our parents are like God to us, especially as we grow up. Like, we always listen to our dad. And after time, they might not know as much as us, but we still take their fucking opinion instead of ours because, you know, they're your dad. They brought you up. You trust them. So you don't even trust no more than your dad. So for your dad to say, boy, you've got something special. You're doing things, you know, that's creating an image in your head. Like, you're starting to paint a picture. You might not see it as clearly as your dad. He's looking at you thinking, fuck me. But you can't see it. But what you started to do is start to create the picture. Well, what is that going to look like then? And it's obviously been played on your mind. And you've kept thinking about the action and then you've took the action. But it always takes that vision of sketching to start to get that, well, I want to find that. You know what I mean? Well, like you said earlier, when it all finished, you was looking for something. So you've got that inquisitive, that curiosity. You know, I think curiosity is a good word to use. That you've got to be curious about where things can go. You know, be a bit, give things a try.
And you,
maybe.
You spot on when you was talking to Jamie about goals. I was setting goals without knowing it though, Rob. It would have been lovely to know you back then because I would have known what I was doing and I may have squeezed a little bit more. I didn't know I was But I didn't think about it. So that might have worked for me, Rob. I weren't really thinking about it, but I thought, I'd go to Peterborough. I'd have my 25, 30 games that season. I've scored them goals. I'm on, right, I want to play in the first division now. Peterborough, Barry Fry's already said we're a selling club. We want to get you the wig. Right, I go to the wig. So I was always setting little stepping stone goals. Do you get what I mean? I never see myself as a Premier League player at Peterborough. All of a sudden, went to Wigan, chipped away. Now I see myself as a Premier League player. Now Premier League ain't enough, Rob. I want to go and win something. I want to get a new contract in the Prem, you know. So all the time, I set myself little goals, achievable goals, to that big goal at the final end was to play for your country. And guess what? I done it. I done it. I didn't play. I got in the squad. I done it. Yeah. But I could never see that at Peterborough, Rob. But I set little goals to finally all of a sudden have the icing on the cake. And then you look back and you go, how the fuck did I do that with my ability? I don't know. Yeah. From a boy at West Ham that was broken, like confidence-wise shattered, with a positive dad and a mum behind me, really strong, with me ability, with my belief, when I gradually got it, my confidence. I'm telling you now, Rob, without the confidence, without my belief, I wouldn't have achieved half what I had.
Yeah.
I'm telling you that now. Do you get what I mean? I worked every ounce out of my body to get to where I got. And that was, because I honestly believe to this day, with the ability I had, everyone says, what was your attribute, Jim? Yeah, I was fit. I believe that, innit? I believe that was my nut was the reason I achieved Premier League football. If you talk to Jimmy Bullard, a 16-year-old in a playground, people go, you're mad. He's never going to do that. And I even half look back and go, nah. 19, nah. 21, nah. 24, believe me, nah. Right. 25, yeah, believable. Reachable. 27, done it. Cracked it.
Yeah.
Unbelievable. But that was because of that, Rob. Not because I could run miles, not because of this, not because of that. I took in, like, Tiger Woods talks about, right? Tiger Woods talks about, I know I'm going off on one, Rob, and that's
I love it, mate. I love it, Jim.
Tiger Woods goes on about, he uses a golf coach, right? He's used some of the best in the world. But he doesn't absorb everything that golf coach tells him. He takes 1-3%. But his golf coach has even come back and says Tiger Woods' strength is discarding what he doesn't need. So not just taking on what you're telling me. Everything you tell me, Rob, or Tiger Woods' coach tells him, might not be for Tiger. But he'll know that. He'll go, discard that. Discard that. That ain't for me. And then he'll tell him one thing and he'll go, he'll grab it with every opportunity and he'll take it to his grave. Do you get what I mean?
Yeah,
so then
1%
every week, all of a sudden, he's made up this beast of a man. Do you get what I mean? And
that's
what he said. And that thing really stuck in me. And he said, Tiger Woods is so good at discarding. Like, because you can take on a load of old waffle, Rob, really good at discarding. Like, because you can take on a load of old waffle, Rob, really, couldn't you? Like, you could listen to everyone and blah, 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 and before you know
you're
spaghetti, isn't you? Your spaghetti brain, and it's game over. But,
You know, it's for a lot of them golfers, they'll have a lot of mind coaches now because a lot of that's visualisation. You know, if you look at anyone in the elite, a lot of footballers, like, if you've been in, you're the elite, you've been Prem, you know, you've got England, didn't you? And you've got, you know, Tiger Woods, he's one of the elite. You know, world champion boxers at the elite. Anyone who's been in that first sort of
don't
level
start
is the
putting
elite.
Me in Tiger Woods' league, Rob. What's that?
No, but you were, I mean, the elite in football. Do you know what I mean? You guys still been on that page. I mean, anyone who's playing in that PJ is the elite. You know what I mean?
Yeah, 100%.
But what I'm saying is the mindset behind all of them is like what you and Jamie said, you didn't know what you were doing. You know, if you study a lot of people, they don't know what they were doing. But the ones that sometimes. What happens is, as you say, like earlier, you get to, like Jamie said, he got to the goal. When he got to Tottenham, he said, I sort of lost my passion a little bit. He said, because money was coming in. He said, there weren't no next goal. He said, if I knew this, when I talk about the reticular activating system, he was sitting there going, I could see the shock on his face. He was like, it's all made sense now. It's all come together. Yeah. You know, if I haven't got that next level of vision, so now I should have been playing for England. I should have been visualising being the best goal scorer for Tottenham. I should have been playing at next level. And that's where I think that's the difference between someone not picking up a coach when they're at that point. And that's what Jamie is so passionate about, doing stuff with a mindset to help footballers from when they finish. And, you know, because, you know, boxers as well, once you come out of your sport, who are you again? You've got self-discovery. What path am I going to take? And then it's easy to go on a downwards
not even sport, though, Rob, is it? It's not just sport.
Anything. Yeah.
That's life.
Anything. Yeah.
That business. In general. Goals are like, as I said, I know I'm going over what you just spoke about, but I'd have loved to have had you when I was 21, 22. God knows what I could have achieved. Because I'm setting goals. Basically, there's a purpose behind my goal setting. I was goal setting without knowing it. So imagine what I could have achieved with purpose, goal setting.
If, if you could program it on purpose,
Do you get what I mean? And not that. We do grow wiser the older we get, I believe. You know, I'm a lot wiser now at 41, a lot more caring than I was when I was 25. Do you know what I mean? I was a bull in a china shop looking back. But do you get what I mean? It's like amazing how much you learn. But yeah, phenomenal, really. And you see more and more people. I would say it's a huge percentage. I reckon there's a lot of every Premier League player or at least team would have a mind coach, 100%. But when I play,
and what I've been to a lot of guys lately in the game in the Prem and things like that, and managers, and a lot of ones I've been lucky enough to speak to, they say they've had cancers there for years, but they don't. You're asking a player, don't do anything. And I always talk about it's their past. There's nothing to really bring them forward. And I think, like, you need to have this forward approach. Because everything's got to be done through paper, through the book. You know, it's got to be done by what's recommended. And honestly, the sports people never got to where you guys never got into that level of success by thinking like these fucking idiots teaching you to think about the past. You guys are the elite. You're creating it's about the future. What's going to happen? Visualizing, you know. And I think there's a big place in sports at the moment. I mean, Gold's been doing it for a long while. Tiger Woods, as you said, they've been having sports coaches and mind coaches all the time, because when I started playing golf, I thought it taught me some of the most lessons, golf, because it's just like life. Whenever you think you've got it, you think you're playing around, you're like, I don't know, a few over, and you think, I've got it now. That's when it goes to crack, it hits you in the nuts, and you think, I've hit the water. You end up losing your temper, hitting the fucking up your next shot. It's all about, right, walking away, getting your pre-shot routine. That's what they do, like a trigger. They practice a pre-shot to calm themselves down. They don't look where the ball's going to go. Then they walk over to the ball and start again. And I think golf teaches you a lot. And I think it's a real good life game. If you look at the lessons in golf, where it teaches you to add to things.
And that's because it's a single sport, like a single person doing it. Do you get what I mean?
Because you've got to discover yourself. You're playing you.
I know you've got your caddy, but you've got to pull the trigger, haven't you? Do you get what I mean? You know, you've got your corner man in boxing. You're going in the ring on your own. You're going in that golf. You're going into that shot on your own. Snooker, another one. Imagine the Crucible Theatre, how quiet that is. Yeah. People don't put enough effort on that.
No, like, that'd be horrible, wouldn't it?
That's got to be the most nerve-wracking sport on it. But, like, the camera comes in close, see you shaking. Like, that's phenomenal. I honestly believe as well that people would work better with a mind coach like yourself. I think it's always been tough to get in football. It's only just started coming in, not recent, but it wasn't around when I was 25, because it's a team sport. And people would be a bit funny having, like, as a 25-year-old, I don't think I would have had the balls to have someone there. Do you get what I mean? Like, I think they, back then, they'd have looked at you a bit different and would have maybe gone, what are you doing, you weirdo? Do you know what I mean?
Now
it's like the dumb thing in sport, the dumb thing in general.
And we're like 20 years behind America. We're like 20 years behind. I've been doing it for years.
100%.
And they've got the good coaches, the California coaches, the ones who I studied with, you know, all the world's elite.
Is that where you went out there?
Well, a lot of them come here as well, to back and forth. Yeah, a lot of them fly over, do training. Like,
okay.
But like, one of my favourite guys, Robert Dilks, is good, NLP guy. Yes, he's one of my faves. But, you know, they're so much in front of us over there. They're so much in front with the mind. And it's and you know, like, Conor McGregor was talking the other day. I see him on an interview, right? And McGregor went, now he's big into visualisation moving forward. And he went, do you know what? He read this article on, is it LeBron James, the basketball player? He spends £1.4 million a year, dollars, £1.4 million on himself for, like, you know, for, like, massages, special machines he gets in, like, you know. And I don't spend nothing. I don't spend a penny. He went, so what he's done now is Conor McGregor. He has a doctor travel with him on.
Yeah.
He's got his own food, doctor. He's took
food,
it on.
Dietrician.
Yeah, dietrician.
He's on it.
All
he's
the time.
On it. I know.
It's only the last fight that he put that into place, but it shows you these Yanks have been doing it for so. They spend over $1 million a year just on people, coaches, and things to work on the mind, because. Yeah. What I've learned, people go and pay money on a pair of shoes, they go and do a monkey on a, you know, a suit, whatever, or a night out, but they don't spend to work on their mind. It's the most important muscle of the old body. They work. Boxers, a lot of boxers are the same. They work in the gym, they graft their nuts off. You start talking about the mind, they go, nah, mate, I've got a lucky rabbit's foot here. Do you know what I mean? You know what I mean? You can't talk about the mind. Got a lucky rabbit's foot, boy, on me. Keep
it up, boy. Knee Jude, and I got this to duck.
The difference between most amateur fighters is done on fitness. I don't care what you say, you get to a certain level, then it's fitness. A lot of the semi pros and pros as well, a lot of them, what they can do with the ball is the same. It's just the vision and the fitness that really can make that little switch.
Yeah, 100%. 100%. You crack me up. Well, what else are we talking about, Rob? Let's talk just quickly. We've got to touch on our dads.
Yeah, we've got to, mate. Yeah, that's what I look.
To all yous listening out, we've got 161 of us at a minute, right? Lovely. Thing that connected me to Rob as well, obviously I see him on the Jamie O'Hara thing. I spoke to him the other week, and my dad, and all yous out there, had a really unique, you might have a dad or someone you know that's had a stroke, but I thought my dad had a stroke, but it was like a speech stroke. So I used to think a stroke was you lost one arm of your body, and you just had one stroke, and like you sort of lost your slurred, lost your speech, and I thought that was a stroke. That but what it, I didn't know was there's thousands of strokes out there. You can have all different kinds of strokes because certain parts of your brain goes and this and that. And my dad had a stroke, and the reason why I'm laughing about it is my dad's fine with it, and I don't mean to laugh because of other people out there. It's just a few funny stories coming back in my head. And I spoke to Rob, and I said, hey, it's my dad, like, he had this stroke and, like, lost his speech, and Rob went to me, yeah, mine did. I went, go on, get away. We just answered some stories.
What? I love his bloke.
Fuck off. Because, hey, Rob, I swear on my life, right? I go in the boozer and me and my old man just start crying because my dad.
Should I tell them quickly about what part of the brain it is? So
go on, please.
What is it? The part of the brain that gets damaged.
But I don't, Rob, you're going to have to explain just quickly. I don't want people to think I'm rude because I'm crying.
No, people, what they won't do is their own dad, isn't it? Only if we're laughing at people with strokes. But what happens with this part of the brain, it's like your library for words. So when you get a vision, so you look at something like, I don't know, a light, your brain registers that word light with it. If you look at a cup, your brain goes cup. If I look at Jimmy, I go Jimmy. Well, that gets it gets destroyed, if you like. And another part of the brain has to grow to take it over. You can get 8% of it back. But in the meanwhile, you might look at a light and say another word. So I'll let Jimmy.
So basically, my dad owns a pub. And you got to understand, for a publican, this is probably the worst stroke you could ever get because he loves meeting people as they walk in the pub. Hello, son, how are you? So you can imagine. And a lot of things for my dad, he gets like, male and female mixed up, right and left mixed up, yes and no mixed up, black and white. So there's a lot of reversals. Like my brother John, he goes John and Jim. Like it's nuts how he gets those things. And then he also gets massive random ones come up. And the first one he's kept in the pub having a drink, and he goes, "Hello, son." And that's a bird, a lady, by the way. He goes, "Hello, son. Do you want a trainer?" And then and the bird was like, "I got a pair, thanks, Jimmy." He goes, "No, you know what I mean." He means a pint, and there's a fucking trainer. But she had a rascal pair of trainers on, and that's what hit him.
Rascal.
Take the trainers, and then. But now he goes, "You know what I fucking mean. You know what I mean." Tosses everything off. He goes, "You know what I mean? It's a speak. It's a speak." And we go, "No, Dad, we don't know what it is." What one did you? You told me one.
When it first happened, right? Because I sound like you never knew there was anything like that. He was living in Manchester, so I drove to Manchester. I mean, I was racing, thinking, like, you know, he's had a stroke, is he going to live, whatever. I got there, when I first walked in there, it was quite daunting, you know, because he didn't reckon it, like, on the side of it. He went to me, "All right, Dan, how you doing? Where's..." I'm like, "What?" Like, I'm thinking, "What the fuck?" So it was like my dad was there, but I felt like his brain had gone. I didn't know what happened at the time.
Exactly.
And I started having a bit of like, I get a bag. I saw, like, some pins and needles. It was like my dad was there, but he was dead, if you know what I mean. It took me out of the game a bit. But as the time went on, he started getting a little bit better, and they explained to me what was going on and everything, and how the part of the mind worked, blah, blah. And we were sitting around there one day, and he can talk a bit now. He's, you know, about a few weeks later, we're talking and that, and the nurse came round, and he went, "How about he meant to say my stroke, "What's going on with my pregnancy?" We've all pissed ourselves laughing, right? We can't help it, that's all. But me and my sister, we're fucking folding on the side. He can.
Where did he get that
pregnancy? And he's like getting frustrated because he can't get the word out.
They take ages to get it, didn't they, sometimes?
Sorry? So he's editing. Yeah, and another one, he used to go down. I don't know how he done. His girlfriend was there, and her name's Janet, right? But he was going, I am Brew. What's her name? I am Brew. And he was getting the right umph, right? And I'm crying laughing. And the nurse went, he knows he's supposed to say Janet, but when it comes out of his mouth, I think he said it saying Janet, but as it comes out of his mouth, it must be horrible, mustn't it? It got a lot better, though.
I know we laugh and I know we joke. And look, if my dad was here, my dad is still here, but if he was actually right here, he gets it and he's fine with it. And my little kids have a laugh with him and this and that, and he's sweet. But it's so frustrating for him. I can see the frustration in his face, mate. And that's one thing. When he gets frustrated, I sort of like ease off on him. But yeah, man, it's such a horrible thing. But look, listen, there's plenty worse out there. He just cracks on, to be fair. But there's some other classic stories, I'm sure, the more we have of these.
What would your advice be to anyone at the minute, Jim? What sort of things you do to keep yourself, I know, because it's hard to get out and, you've got your TV and things you're doing, but you can't do them. What keeps you going for the day now? What's your...
I didn't realise, until this happened, I didn't realise how much I relied on my hobbies, which was golf and fishing. I rely on them so much. I do them heavily. Like, I'll go fishing 3 times a week, which is a full day, twice a week minimum. And then I'll go golf, which I can go up to 3, 4, 5 days a week, depending on work. So I'm so privileged and I rely on them. I didn't know how much I really relied on them because, as I said before, I'm not a deep thinker and I'm very off the cuff and I'm very thinking forward. And if I want to go golf, as long as everyone's right around me, I'll go golf. And if I don't plan too much, you get what I mean? So all of a sudden this come up, COVID-19, now I'm banging trouble. I'm like, whoa.
Well, held up, yeah.
4 days in, I'm like, I need a goal. I listened to you and Jamie Ara's thing, Free. You was really early on that.
Yeah, we caught it by about 2 days.
And James, I'm not just saying video,
so we jumped on it, yeah.
I'm not just saying it because you're on it. I started following you straight away, didn't I? I messaged you. I think, boys, keep going because I'm interested. I think you've done it in 4 parts. And I'm not just saying it because I'm on the phone with you now and people think I'm blagging. I went there and I was like, I need a goal here. I do need a goal. I need a goal. And this time, do you know what it is? Landscaping. I've always liked landscape. I'm doing the patio. I've got the bits here that I need. I thought, I'm going to get into that. And I'm at...
I've lost you.
Got me?
I've got you.
I heard you go up, leave up. The boxy phone's driving. You're like me. Drive you mad, didn't they? Oh, I've lost the phone. Left, right, centre. So basically, you get back to the question... Landscape. I don't care what goal it is, it really drives me, Rob. I absolutely loved it. I needed my garden. My garden was all right. It just let the property down. I went bang, bang, and I'm in the middle of doing them. I'm just crunched straight on, and
brilliant.
That's what's got me bang out. So I found my own goal. You get what I mean?
Yeah.
And I thought, I need something. Last 10 days. Problem is,
But again, anyone watching, you can clock Jimmy again out, find another goal. It's like something you do naturally. You know, something about earlier. Naturally look for something, you know what I mean? And you say you're always happy, and that is the trick, I think. Just keep yourself, you're only happy when you move forward, aren't you? Achieving the goal sometimes happier than getting the goals. Once you get it, you have this fire buzz, I've done it, but now it can only come down. There's nothing else, do you know what I mean? To go towards.
It's mad. I'm just going to pick up on your looking forward thing, right? I do Soccer AM on the weekend. Fenner's phoned me, and we're going to do a little show tomorrow on Soccer AM. A little look back at my career. Be honest, Rob, where I look forward so much, I never took the opportunity to look back.
And I'm like, what
I've done. And I achieved some great things, like some fantastic. And it is great to look back sometimes. And I've thought forward so much. And we're all in a rush. And that's another thing this COVID-19 took. Just sometimes, stand still. Have a look what's around you. Have a look what you've done. Have a look at your mistakes and your good doings, whatever you want to call them. Go, hang on. Just take your time. We're 100 mile an hour sometimes, isn't we?
It is. It's true. You think, you just get pulled up in that rat race. And sometimes you end up getting so fast, you're doing other people's dreams. You don't even know what you're doing. Everything's just pulling you out of the door all the time. And I think when I talk about So I don't like generalisation, but what I mean is, when I talk about anything I talk about, I always mean it on a, like an 80-20 rule, because there's always good when it's bad, there's always bad when it's good. So,
yeah, like,
you know, like 80% of the time, look forward, but you do need to have that time to look back. And I remember my dad, in my, he's passed now, fucking, I might have me a little tear and that, and I'm an happy sad, do you know what I mean? So I remember him from what man he was, or I look back at what I've achieved and things I've done, like you said. And then, but if you just spend 80% in your life going towards your goal and 20% looking back, the majority of people are spending 80% looking back and 20% looking forward. And if you try walking forward, looking backwards, you want to fucking walk, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
It looks like you've walked in.
I look like I walked into
it. Where's your bins anyway? Where's your bins, boy? You love a pair of bins.
My bins, yeah, I do, yeah. I ain't got no.
All them photos you're sending me, fully binned up.
Binned up, mate, yeah. Yeah, it was the summer. That was, yeah. I was reminiscing looking back. How good I looked good back then, that last year. But no, but it's good again. Also, looking back at the good things can make you feel good as well. I mean, goodish, you know what I mean?
That's what I got on. So we're looking back at my career, all the stuff that I've done, good, bad, indifferent. But then a few questions come through and a few games. I was like, blimey, yeah, like, you know, that'd be a lovely thing tomorrow. Do you get what I mean? Because I'm looking forward to that, looking back and picking up. Because what I don't think, don't get me wrong, YouTuber come up and there'd be an old clip of me and I'm doing something. I watch bits and bits just come up naturally as they do in life. But I've never took time to watch all my old things and all my old bits back and sit down and think week by week, month by month, you ain't going to go week by week. But you know what I mean? Like game by game, year by year, just skirt around my career for a couple of hours, what I achieved. I think that's going to be an amazing thing. So even though I look forward all the time, I've never done that. So I'm looking forward to that. Do you get what I mean? That'd be a good feeling, hopefully. Do you get what I mean?
Especially, it's great when you, I suppose, as we, you know, we, our kids grow up and you can shit arm and that. And it's good, isn't it, to look back and give them the, well, I could be, you know, it's inspiring, you know?
Yeah,
but I do
think,
but that is, I mean, every time I achieve a little goal, it ain't till, and I'm visualising so much, I do the same all the time and I get something can happen and I think, oh, hang on a minute, that was like 7 months ago. I want nowhere near this place, and now I'm at this place. And I think that's when you know that that's what life's about. And see, what I like to explain it to people is you've got your thoughts here and now, your thoughts of the past and thoughts of the future. Now, depression is this, and I don't care what depression you clinically want to fucking call it. If you don't see a future, you're depressed. When my dad died, I couldn't see the world without him, so I kept thinking of what's happening today, which is fuck all, because I'm depressed, and I'm thinking of the past, how he died.
So you had depression.
When your dad dies, it's a bit hard not to be depressed. You know what I mean? Right, yeah. Okay. I mean, I've been depressed when my dad died. I think it's hard not, because when someone, something like that happens, when I lost my dad, I've lost my granddad and other people and friends, but when it was my dad, look, you don't ever see the world without your dad. You don't even, like, you know it'll happen one day, but my dad was only 58, so I never got this. It's the shock of it as well. You're not worried about going to work. You don't give a fuck what anyone's got to say. You start to get angry and it's horrible, and you sort of look back all the time. You're thinking about the cancer. I remember visualising taking his last breath. It was very painful for me for about 3 months. And one day I had a little normal moment. I thought, what am I doing? All the techniques I've got, why the fuck am I? So what I've done is I reframed the images I was seeing. So I kept seeing images of him with cancer, the images of him with, you know, taking his last breath. He's going blind in one eye as he laid there dying the last 24 hours and stuff, like all this horrible stuff. And I thought, what the fuck am I doing? Hey, my dad, that's cancer. My dad was the guy that when I was born to the day he got cancer, that was my dad. I've got to focus on
and
that.
And what made you do that though, Rob? What made you do that? Did you see someone? Did you think of it yourself?
No, mate, I just come through that. I mean, I figured it out because I know about the imagery and what you should be focusing on. I've never thought about it for a long time because I was in this horrible depressed state. When I got a little bit of a gap, and I could get my head together for a minute, after about 3 months, I started changing my visions. And as I changed my visions, I started focusing on it more. So then I started looking at, then I started thinking, my dad was looking down if there was an heaven, say, right?
He don't want you to look alike.
Mate, him can't see, what are you doing, you mad? That's your fucking dad. Remember me looking like a fucking zombie? Get a fucking grip. How about I took your football? How about when we took your boss? How about we done you?
Yeah.
That's who I am. That's fucking cancer. And I could hear his voice even saying it to me. So what I sort of learned is, a lot of people are grieving, and a lot of people I deal with who are grieving, they sort of love this story, because what I'll say is, you've got to grieve, but grieve intelligently. If you spend, you know, the time's focusing on your dad dying of cancer, that's painful. That ain't even your dad. Yeah. That's cancer. So you don't focus on your dad coming in the world, out your nan's jacket, you know what I mean, out your nan's bits. You don't visualise, don't think of that. So why do you think I'm going out the world? It's none of your fucking business. How they come in the universe, how they leave, ain't our business. So I mean, I looked at it as when he got cancer and he started getting ill, that was him going out. All right, there's nothing I can do about it. It's not my business. I don't want it to happen. But that's what I shut off from. And I think if you focus on the bit from when you was born to the day you got ill and you visualise that man, I cry about a smile because I'm missing the fella that was. So when I see his image of him, they don't even know bad. They don't even know bad because if he was to call me a little... Say you and say yourself, I was being naughty when I was little. I'll get him saying, get here, you little. And I'll start laughing now.
Yeah.
There ain't no, when he passes, there ain't no bad memories. It's a good, they're all good memories.
You've sort of trained your brain. You don't want no weak images coming in, do you? You just want positive images.
Positive. And as I said, even the positive arguments you've had of him become funny because you'd love him to call you. If he was still there now, I'd be laughing, I'd be like, oh, I feel blessed that he's
here.
You know what I mean?
But you know what? I know it's a bit soppy, but I've even gone one step ahead of that. I've sort of done like the odd pic and video with me, my mum, my dad, my kid. Because we all go.
Yeah.
We all go and we never know when we all go. Like, let's have
That's right.
I started just doing that, so I'm ready. Do you get what I mean? I know it sounds a bit morbid, doesn't it?
Hang on a minute, I lost him 77,
Dom was. I fished with him all the time and lost him. He was ill December time, 3 months he was gone. And I thought, I had one picture of me and Don, I had one picture, it was a blinder, it was me and him after fishing, it was in a silhouette, and he was the youngest 77-year-old. He beat me in a 10-yard race about 2 years ago. On my life, if you see this bloke in a silhouette, you'd go, he's 45. He's 45, Don. Yep, Don Garnish, absolute fishing legend around Surrey. He's an absolute legend, the man, one of my good mates. And I took a photo of him. And I went, look at that. I've started doing videos and things because no one, just the close mates and close people, just because I need them one day. Do you get what I mean? Yeah, and that's how I want to remember them. We was all lagging, me and my mates the other day. And I'm not a busy bastard. You know, when you get your phone out, your mates go, you busy bastard. You won't say that when you're fucking dead and I'm looking at them, it'd be a blinder. Just to liven them up and get myself out of it and bring them back down. I don't care no more, Rob. I'm going to have a look, have the videos, all them slagging me up. Imagine looking back at that, it'd be a blinder.
It'd be brilliant.
That's what I'm saying. I'm one step ahead. I'm literally, you know, I'll probably fucking go before all of them and I'll be gutted. But there you go.
Remembering people through they were, not how they died. And I think it's hard when you sit and see someone die who you love. That's the hard thing because you don't normally have to visit someone else. When it's someone you love, you've got to sit and watch him, you know, slowly take their last breath. That's what can get caught in your head. And I think in that circumstance, you've got to realise that you've got to focus on who they was. And then when you start practising these images, there's techniques I use to put them to the front of my head and to people and my clients' heads. But when you get that, so now, on the 10th of May is the day, his birthday, I get upset, Christmas, but the one that does me is 10th of May, the day he died for some reason. I got all his mates, we go up to our bridge, meet all his pals from Birmingham, they have a booze, they tell me the same fucking stories every year. And I have my little moment, I get there a bit early, I have a pint, and I go out on the Thames a bit normally, and I'm thinking with dad, but I'm happy, I get a little tear come down my face, but I'm smiling, because I'm thinking of something funny, or me and him. So I'm sad, but it's happy sad, because I'm actually grieving for me dad, not for how he died, you know what I'm saying?
Kaz Comp, do you know Kaz Comp?
Yeah, what's she put?
Jim, Robert never puts his phone away anyway.
What's she say? It's my cousin.
Robert never puts his phone away anyway. I thought that was funny.
My cousin Karen, that is. Yeah, it's true. I'm fucking always on the phone, mate. Always working on it. I'll do everything on my phone now. Dad's got my diary on it.
Though, Rob, right? I'm not licking your ass, right? I've seen a lot of sports psychs. I've seen, especially when I was injured, Fulham thought I was mad. I'm not even joking. Fulham actually thought I was mad. And I sat down with two or three. No one. I don't know whether it's me. You're so clear. And it's easier to like, I don't know what it is. I don't know whether it's because you talk like me, whether you react. Do people say like, or is that your profession and you're good and you understand the character, so you're hitting points?
I'm always myself. I've had people go to me, oh, you swear a lot. Okay, if you don't like it, fuck off. I'm not the one that needs help. You know what I mean?
It's mad how you say that. It's mad how you say that. Because I connect to that. Do you get what I mean? I think I connect to that. So
because I think if you're real and you're yourself, like I learned years ago, I'm dyslexic, Jim, I have ADHD. So when I used to go in sales years and years ago, I worked for a German company, and I used to feel insecure because I used to think I want posh, I'd be in my suit. And, hi, Rob, you sit down. I go, hello, yes, I've got this product, I look like a white prick. Would you like to see this? And I couldn't sell shit. It wasn't until I started realising I've got to be myself. Yeah. And I just want to go out, wank, it does a cup of tea. And my clients all of a sudden started loving me when I started being myself. And I think I learned that through the psychologies I learned, though, from America.
But life's a lot easier when you... I think that come. Does that come with age as well and experience, do you reckon, Rob?
I think we figure a lot of stuff out. Like, you know, it's like golf, isn't it? You can have lessons and you can become a single figures handicap in a few years, or you can learn yourself and do it in 20. It's that sort of thing, do you know what I mean? It's like, maybe.
I've got you. I'm dinging everyone. I've had four calls. That's a call.
I'm sorry, mate.
I'm enjoying this a lot. It's a nice bit of therapy. It really is.
But I think what it is with me, Jim, I just like to just, I don't like to fuck about, because I look at the process to change and to recovery, or the processes to achievement. And the processes to thought are the same in everyone's brain. So I'll give you an idea of a process, right? I teach you why diets make people fat, right? I'll tell you this is a fact, because the unconscious, but if you look behind the scenes, what's going on, diets teach you to think, like, not, this is a weight loss diet, not a gym, not an athlete's diet. Yeah. I'm on about a weight loss diet.
Yeah.
A weight loss diet is different. So the diets teach people to think about food, right? That's the first part of the process. They get you to think about, they give you a meal, and they go, what you're having for dinner, what you're having for lunch, what you're having for breakfast, what you're having for tomorrow, what you're having Wednesday, what you're having Thursday. And you focus on all these fucking meals throughout the week. So now you're thinking about food even more, right? Then, that ain't enough. They teach you what's in the fucking food. So now you're hyper-focusing, the good carbs, the bad carbs, the trans fats, the saturated fats. So now you're hyper-focusing on food. Now imagine this, right? If you was an alcoholic, as a therapist, a good therapist would make you want to have less thoughts of alcohol. If you was a gambler, as a therapist, I want you to have less thoughts of gambling. I won't go and teach you about fucking horses and jockeys, would I? Let's teach you about horses and jockeys this week and you're going to stop gambling. You think I was a lunatic. But you get someone overweight and they're a bit fat, and you go, what do you want to do? I want to lose a bit of weight. Oh, no, let's teach you to think about food a bit more.
That's true, actually.
Just even the first thought. Yeah. That's not even a process. That's just the opening line. So on the day, they teach you to think about food. The second part is they restrict you from food. So they say, you can have lettuce, you can have your meal, you can have your shake at lunch, you can have this. But now the restriction goes in. You can't have chocolate, you can't have crisp, you can't have a curry, you can't have a pint, you can't go out with your mate, you know what I mean? So all of a sudden, they put a load of restriction in. Now, the only way the human body can crave anything is to be restricted from it. You can only crave something you can't have. If you can have it, you can't crave it. It's there. So you're taught to think about food, you're restricted from food, then you go on a diet for 2 weeks in restriction. Like anything you restrict of energy, it can only build for so long, and the restriction gets, you can only withstand it so long, and then, bum, it comes flying down. And then you go to the, like, someone might, you might do 2 weeks of the diet, and someone will go, oh, you look well, you lost a bit of weight. And someone will go, oh, we've been on this diet, yeah, I'm doing really well. And they get home, look at them, and think, oh, I've lost a bit of weight off my face. You know what? I'll have a little treat. And they go to the cupboard and have that little biscuit. Next thing you know, they're fucking scoping the fuck out of themselves, and they've broke the diet, yeah, because the restrictions broke, and you shove loads of food in your mouth. So now you're taught to think about food. Then you get restricted from food, the restriction breaks, and then you feel like a failure because diets don't fucking work. No one's ever sustained their life on Weight Watchers until they died. No one's ever sustained herbal life until they died and without breaking the rules.
It can't happen.
So if it can't be sustained, it don't work, for one. But what's happened is, if you look back in time before the 1970s, there was no obesity. It was minute. Look at the studies. Obesity was minute. Sugar diabetes, mind you, that was more than just old people back in the 70s. And the first diet was made in California, called the California diet. That was the first ever one. And then from there, you just see it spike up. The Western world is getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. We had 2 million years of evolution with nothing. So they teach you to think about food restriction, and food restriction breaks, you feel like a failure. You repeat the process, try another diet. You're blaming yourself, the issue. And you get to a point where you think, what's the point of trying? And now they're fucked, yeah? Now it's a mind thing. Now it's not about the food. So now they're obsessed with thinking about food, what they can't have, looking at how bad they look, they focus on fat. Now, if you followed any of my videos about the reticular activating system I've done with Jamie, you'll see what you put your energy on, you know, you become. What you focus on, you become. So now they've taught you to think about all these things more. You're putting your focus on them more, and you're saying, I want to lose weight, and you're getting bigger. So that's the process behind a diet, them steps. Think about food, restriction breaks, feel like a failure, and you keep repeating the process. And
Time, right?
That's like, if you apply that process everyone gets the same. Everyone's going to get the same outcome because it's a process to fault.
Yeah.
It ain't the content. The diet's the content. Which food you should eat. You know, there's ones with fat. There's ones with. I don't deal with content at all. It's all deal with the process. And I think if you get the process of success, this is what studies are proving, is that if I was to spend the day with you modelling your mind of the things you're good at, I could never get no one to do it 100% like Jimmy Bullard, but I could probably get them to a 70%. I'd probably get a group of 10 people up to a level of 70, 80% as good as you. Now you've got 10 players all on the same sort of level. So that's the sort of... Now, the Americans have been doing it. Anthony Robbins, people like that, have been doing it for years, mind modelling. So if you look at the processes instead of the content, that's the difference, I think. So it doesn't matter what people think of me. If I apply the process, you're going to change. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, 100%.
Fuck me, I went on a bit there, Jim, didn't I?
No. I've got to say, what are you fucking saying? I need to go on a diet. Is that what you're saying? I'm absolutely true.
Mate, off you. Look at that, look. There's nothing. Off you, mush.
Hey!
You look like a young Bruce
anyway,
Lee, Jimmy.
I want 20 seconds clap off you for the NHS club. They're all clapping. They're coming, mate.
Coming, everyone. Clap
everyone's in. Saying NHS clap. So they've been absolutely fantastic, haven't they? Yeah.
They were outside.
At the NHS, eh? Blind.
Oh, God bless them, mate. They've done an amazing job, haven't they? It's absolutely incredible.
And what are you, just quickly, Rob, what are you saying about all this? This is just mad times, isn't it? This is like, we'll never witness this again, I don't think.
Anyway. Nah, I don't, I hope not to.
It's just madness.
Anything coming back as bad as this or worse, I hate it, nah.
Enough of, how have you been getting on with it as well? What have you?
Hey, you know what? I've turned into Forrest Gump. I just stop fucking walking. I've got ADHD. I can't sit still. So I get up in the morning. I go for a 3 mile walk. Come back. Have a little sanctuary. Do some work. Then I drive to the woods where no one is. And then I just do another 5 mile walk. And I come home and then I'm doing me bits and pieces. You know what I mean? We work indoors. But I just can't stop walking, mate. I'm just like...
Really?
Yeah. But I'm loving it now. When I get out of the field, I start walking 5 miles. It's brilliant. I'm really enjoying it. But,
and where do you live?
Brentwood, near Brentwood.
I'll tell you what I've been doing, bike ride. Another thing, I know it's all bangs everywhere. I can hear them all clapping up and down.
They've got the pots out.
What was I going to say? Fucking, you realise where you live. Where I just usually dart around in a car, I don't realise. I haven't took it in where I live. It's lovely where I live. But fucking just getting on the road, put me head down, drive to work, drive to the shops, drive to wherever... Now I've took time, mate, unbelievable places. Like, we've had a little fishing lake 2.5 minutes from my house. Like, I never knew it was there.
Nah.
Ridiculous. Yeah.
A nice one, yeah?
Rob, it's unbelievable.
He likes fishing. Jamie likes a bit of fishing, did he?
Yeah, we've done, with Ali, we've done that together. The big fish shop.
So
we've done that, and first day, I've done. Am I going on? Have you got to go or not? You're all right.
No, sweet, mate. I'm good as well.
I'm at home. I'm going down to Devon because it's down in Cornwall, Angler's Paradise, me and Jamie. I'm going down there. It's a bit light. Let me get in the light. Look, that's better. I'm going down to there filming some fishing. The night before, I've ordered Domino's chicken wings. So I've had the chicken wings, but they looked a bit silky, like not cooked. So I've tore through them next day. I'll end up down there. I've ended up sick as a pig 4 days. You know what it's like when you're ill and you're not in your own bed? It's the worst. Yeah. And I'm 3 hours away. So we shot the fish in. First day, I'm sick as a pig. That prat knows I'm sick as a pig, Jane. He's come up behind me, rugby tackled me in my back. I'm talking...
No.
I thought he broke my back. I'm going, are you all right, Jay? You're an absolute unit. I'm built like a stick, and you're like daunting me. Honestly, 3 days, I've got to get that bastard back. Last day, we teed it up. I've launched him in the lake in a rugby tackle. Mate. But it was so deep and cold. I've got wellies on. I can't swim properly. I've shit myself. And he's grabbing me. So I've done myself again. Backfired. Jamie don't care, does he? It's ice cold.
No.
He's swimming around it like a big up there. And something wrong with you. So it backfired. But we had a great time. We love our fishing. I'll tell you what I'd like to do, right? I'm thinking of doing a podcast while I'm fishing. So on the bank, shoot it all nicely.
Yeah,
I'd like you on my podcast.
I'd love that, Jim. Thank you, mate.
Next to me, it looks slick. Have you on? Get into what you're doing. Just have a chat like this.
Yeah.
It'd be pucker. Do you get what I mean?
That'd be blind. That's a good idea. Well. Sorry?
perhaps have Jamie on as well, whatever.
Yeah, get me and Jamie on. Yeah, me and Jamie come on. It's brilliant.
So it'd be like a chat.
That'd be good because you can both got the similar stories of the football, and yeah, that'd be blinded. Rodcast, aren't
we? Plus, we're fishing. Do you know what I mean? Plus, we're fishing. It'd be funny, wouldn't it?
Yeah,
but you got to film them these days. Everyone's filming their podcast, so absolutely, that's what I want to do anyway.
Yeah, that'd be brilliant. But Jim, thank you for your time, mate.
No, Rob, it's lovely to. No, can you hear me? Yeah.
Yeah, got you, mate. Yeah.
Lovely, look, lovely to meet you on here. No, I've not met you properly, but I'm gonna.
No, when all this is over.
We'll have a pint. I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll
have a try,
because we're having a lot of love on this. Loads of people are loving this. What we'll do, when we're all back, I'll talk to you anytime you want. But when we're back, I'm going to take you in the pub, meet the old man. We're going to have a drink, and we're going to get on Insta. We'll put a few lives out and get a few people that have been on here to get us on the live while we're there, all right?
Definitely. That'd be a blinder. That'd be good, wouldn't it? Jim, thank you for your time, mate. It's been a legend. My third one of the series. So thank you, mate.
You're a legend.
Appreciate it. God bless you. Absolute legend, Jim. Proper gentleman. Yep. Thank you.
Top man. Bye, boy. Bye, mate.
I'll see you later, mate.
Bye, Rob. Keep all the good work up.
Thank you, Jim.